Hello friends, today we are going to take a very interesting topic in the finance, and we are going to touch one of the key domain area of a finance, that is the banking system. So if you talk about the banking system in India, the system can be broadly been divided into two parts, that is the organized sector and unorganized sector. So as far as rules and regulations are concerned for the banking system, these all comes under the organized sector. Unorganized sector is actually the sector where there is no rules and regulations is there in the existence, and but this sector do exist in India. So you know, we take the discussion forward to the organized sector, what comprises of the organized sector, and what are the components of the bank, what type of banks which are operating in India, and how their operations are different as far as the entire banking system is concerned. So if we take the broad idea of the banking system, the banking system, as my previous slide suggested, is divided into two parts, that is organized and unorganized sector. First, we are going to talk about the organized sector. Organized sector is the one where the supreme authority is Ministry of Finance, which gives the suggestions, guidelines, which is there to be implemented by the Reserve Bank of India. Reserve Bank is actually taking care of the entire banking system in India, which belongs to the organized sector. This entire banking system can be divided into three parts, that is commercial banks, cooperative banks, and development banks. If we look at the commercial banks can further be divided into four categories, that is SBI and the group banks. Now all these group banks are, you know, going to be soonly become the part of the State Bank of India, since it is a legacy bank and it have been operating in India for last 200 years. Then the other nationalized banks comes into the picture. For example, we can say Punjab National Bank, Bank of Baroda, Syndicate Bank, Punjab and Sindh banks. Then third, the bank which is there in India for the existence, these are known as the regional rural banks. Regional rural banks are actually formulated in India to promote the rural sector, which does not have an access to the banking facilities. So as a part of the financial inclusion, the government of India has actually decided that they need to bring the rural sector into the formal banking system. So they have established the specialized banks which are there for the rural areas, which are there for the upliftment of the rural areas, that is the regional rural banks. Next, in the same category belongs to the private banks, and in private banks we have two parts, that is foreign banks and Indian origin banks. Foreign banks are those banks which are originated in the country which is not India, but they are doing the business operations in India. Second category that comes into the picture, that is we are talking about this category, that is the cooperative banks. Cooperative banks are actually established under the Cooperative Society Act, and these are actually based on the, you know, mutual cooperation among people. So this can also be further divided into two parts, state, central and primary. The basic difference between the commercial banks and the cooperative society banks are this. The cooperative society banks works generally within the particular state because of the operations of the Cooperative Society Act. And as far as the commercial banks are concerned, they are operating, you know, all over India. Once you get the license from Reserve Bank, you can operate the banks through all over India. Second basic difference that comes into the picture as far as commercial banks and cooperative banks are concerned, the capital requirement. The capital requirements to establish a commercial bank is huge. That is actually in crores. But if we talk about the commercial banks, this capital requirement is quite less. Let us, for an example, if we say that if you want to establish a nationalized bank, then the capital requirement will be 3000 crore rupees. But as far as the cooperative banks are concerned, depending upon where we are establishing these can be established with the mere capital of 1 crore rupees. since they are not, the capital requirement are not as such huge. Third category which comes into the picture is the development bank. Development banks can further be divided into these four categories, like Exim, Industrial, Agricultural and Housing Bank. So if we talk about the system of apex banking system, the Reserve Bank is the apex, only one bank which is operating in India, which is there to control the system, regulate the system. If we take the example of the development bank, these development banks can further be divided into four parts: Exim, Industrial, Agricultural and Housing. These are also the apex banks. Normal common people are not dealing with these banks. These are there and performing the system, you know, to strengthen the banking scenario in India. These are actually dealing with the commercial banks, and commercial banks will then be facilitating whatever policy needs to be executed. For example, if Mr. A wants to take loan for the agricultural purposes, he is going to approach his bank, which may be a SBI bank. Okay. But State Bank of India, how they ensure that the money which is coming to them in the form of the deposit needs to be go to the agricultural sector. They will submit the report that these people are coming and demanding the money for the agricultural purposes. These money will be allocated to SBI through agricultural apex bank, that is NABARD. It means money will be floating from Reserve Bank to NABARD and from NABARD to SBI. Okay, so this is how the entire banking system works. Now we move to the next slide. If we see the organized sector, which actually differentiate between the organized and unorganized sector, is organized sector is a sector where there are rules, regulations and laws applicable in India. What type of rules which are applicable to the organized sector, which differentiate the organized from the unorganized sector, is first we talk about any bank operating in India has to follow the guidelines, the directions, the provisions which are laid down by the Reserve Bank of India. Second rule which is applicable, second act which is applicable, is the Banking Regulation Act. Third act is, in India every bank is also a company, so they must comply with the rules and regulation as per Companies Act 2013 and any other direction given by the Government of India for the banking system. So these four, you know, are basic broad guidelines in which the entire banking system of India is being working as far as organized sector is concerned. Then if we talk about the unorganized sector is the sector where there are no rules and regulation. All act discussed in the previous slides are irrelevant since it is an unorganized sector. This sector do exist in India and there are major players. Since, you know, our Prime Minister also wants that everybody should come into the organized set of banking system, since some kind of rules and regulations are there for the help of the people. But as far as unorganized sector is concerned, there is no, you know, rules and regulation. For example, the highest capping in the organized sector for the loan is 16 to 18% as far as personal loans are concerned. But if we talk about the unorganized sectors, lendings are done at a way high rate. Sometime in case of the urban area, it is 2% per month, which makes 24% per annum. And in rural sector, which find it is approximately 3% per month, which belongs to 36% per annum. So this such a huge interest rate never, you know, have been, you know, decided by the government that these interest rate has to be imposed. But still, these sector do exist in India and people till date find it very easy to get funds from the unorganized sector in comparison to the unorganized sector. So what comprise of the unorganized sector? These are the private financier, local shopkeeper, sahukars and private money lenders. These are all the major players who are actually giving the support of a finance if somebody wants to take money from them. So these are the major players. So the question arises is, even after, you know, so much of education about the finance in the banking sector, is this sector really exist in India? The answer to the question is very much, you know, we can say that this system still exists, because of, you know, following reasons. First may be inefficiency. Second is lack of knowledge about the banking product. Some people don't have, you know, trust. Some people don't have the assets so that they can hypothecate the asset to get the funds from the bank. So, and some people believe that the deposits in the banking system are not secure and the fraud might take place in case of banking system. See, as far as bank deposits are concerned, there is the some kind of assurance by the DICGC, Deposit Insurance Credit Guarantee Corporation of India, where deposit till up to the extent of 1 lakh has been secured and has been guaranteed by the Reserve Bank of India. Any deposits above this sum is unsecured. But still, as far as the prudential norms in banking is concerned, so, you know, the banking system still, you know, play a very vital role, and the deposits are pretty secure in comparison to the other financial instruments. So why this unorganized sector, why these, you know, players are still surviving? Because they have got huge, you know, network and bargaining power. There is huge network and the bargaining power, which makes them, you know, they are the active player in the market. So what is now to learn from this is, yes, the unorganized sector do exist in India. Organized sector is also there. But somewhere this organized sector has to take care of the unorganized sector. It means people who are still, you know, using the funds from the unorganized sector, these, some of they have to be brought under the organized sector, so that at least some kinds of, you know, regulations, support, that it should be there, and they should, at the end of the day, they should not be feed cheated if they are borrowing money from anyone. Thank you.